Hello, friends, and welcome back to r/ProRevenge. And our first story about another angry neighbor. But before we begin, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you're new here, and turn on notifications so you don't miss a new video every single day. Here we go. Be a good neighbor, says the harassing note. So I live in a suburban area of a fairly large city, renting a basement suite with a friend. I moved into this spot recently and would say I'm a pretty chill person to live around. I work full-time and go to classes, so I'm rarely home, so basically never disruptive. One important thing about this neighborhood is that it has no driveways, but street parking is plentiful, and it's never hard to find a spot within steps of your house on either side of the street. I've been parking directly across the street from my place, as that way I don't have to turn around when I get home, and there's always been spots in front and behind me. I tend to only drive my car about once a week, and getting into it this morning, I noticed multiple notes. The first, a full page tucked under my wiper blades, read, "Be a good neighbor. Park on your side of the street like you told us." What the hell? I just moved into this neighborhood and have certainly never spoken to anyone on the street. Also strange and unsettling that they would know I live on the other side of the street, as that means they've watched me leave my car, and I tend to only drive really late since I work the night shift. Since apparently I didn't respond quickly enough to their first note, they then left a second, a series of question mark post-its on my windshield. I think, whatever, probably just an over-controlling old person, it's no biggie for me to turn around and park on the other side of the street. I park on the correct side of the street, wanting to avoid confrontation, until the other night. I'd gotten off late from work, pull into my street, park, and hop out of my car before I totally register that I didn't turn around. At this point, it's 1:30 a.m., and I'm like, whatever, I'm sure it won't affect anyone. Wrong. The next morning, there was an even more passive-aggressive sticky note on my windshield, calling me inconsiderate and disrespectful. Cool, I can do that. I have a membership to a car-sharing service in the city. How it works is you can unlock a car from an app, pay by minute that you drive, then park it and leave it in allowable zones. One such zone is on my street. I decide I'm going to do a little commute home and find every car within walking distance from me. One by one, I rent each car, driving to my street and parking it directly across from my house. By the time I'm done, within a quarter block, there is a series of rental cars taking all the north side spots. Of course, I left lots of spaces directly across the street, so there was plenty of space to park. I hope my neighbors love their parking options on the public street. And our second story. Steal my tools? I'll flood your toolbox. So this happened years ago, when I was only 19 years old. I was a general service slash lube technician for an auto repair chain around here. I was up and coming, trying to gain as much knowledge as possible, and trying to become a certified mechanic at the time. My job with this chain started at one location, and I loved it. The techs there did everything they could to teach me, to help me learn, and what I needed to add to my list of tools to buy. Now, I was lucky. My dad was a retired mechanic and had given me all of his tools. I had very nice equipment, all Snap-on, and all very expensive. Cut to about 4 months into working here, and management told me they were shorthanded at another location closer to my house, and they were going to transfer me to that shop instead. I wasn't happy with it, since I was learning so much where I was, but I obliged. The transfer went through a week later, and I started my first day at the shop from hell. Immediately, there was a bad vibe there. Nobody got along with each other. The techs thought they were hot stuff, and the lube guys didn't care enough about their jobs to learn anything. They all hated the management and service riders equally. That being said, my chance to learn my craft was severely hindered. Still though, I came in every day and gave it my all. That is until one of the techs decided it'd be funny to steal two of my wrenches, amounting to about $90. How did I know he stole them? Well, he told me. He thought it was funny to tell me he took them, then deny it up and down to management, but then when he and I were alone, he would demand a ransom if I wanted them back. Obviously, on principle alone, I wasn't going to pay him a dime. Meanwhile, he kept laughing and thinking he was the funniest guy in the world for several days. After several tries with both my direct management and the HR department, I wasn't getting anywhere at all. Nobody could prove he took anything. He denied it happened, and they refused to take any action. They definitely refused to replace my tools. It was time to take matters into my own hands. Being a shop that closed at 6, it was usually only myself and a service rider that stayed until closing, and everyone else, including the a-hole tech, left at 5. It was at closing time that my plan would be put into place. On a particular day, about 4 days later, it was closing time, everyone else but myself and the service rider had left. The service rider was working the front counter with the customer, and I was closing up the back shop. I shut everything down, including the air compressor, but on this particular day, I didn't let the 80 gallons of compressed air out of the tank. I then took one of the oil dispensers, which was used for refilling the engine oil during a service, closed the cap, and zip-tied the handle open. The only thing keeping the dispenser from dumping oil was the cap being closed, but it was under the full pressure of the still aired up 80-gallon compressor. As we got wrapped up and hit 6 o'clock, the rider and I were walking out the front door of the building getting ready to lock up. I jumped, told him I forgot something, and had to run back into the shop real quick. When I got back there, I took my slide hammer, which I had ready to use already, and popped the lock off this technician's 3-bay Matco toolbox. I grabbed the oil dispenser, popped the cap open, propped it into the hole in the toolbox, and then ran back outside. The service rider was none the wiser. As the alarm set and the door got locked, all 80 gallons of compressed air emptied the fresh motor oil into every orifice and drawer of his toolbox, onto the floor where he had his boxes of clothes, and all over his work bays. I never came back to work after that, and about 2 weeks later, corporate ended up sending me a check for the full replacement value of my tools with an apology. I heard from someone else that worked there that he spent 2 full days cleaning up the mess, but still had to replace some of his tools because he could never get all the oil out. Was what I did harsh? Maybe. Don't mess with a man's tools. And our third story. Told not to stand at the supervisor's desk. Okay. So a little backstory. I ran a machine at a company for a while before they did away with it. They didn't fire me, so I would just help different people on a day-to-day basis. However, the machine sat at its normal place until we moved to a new building. The story. So after the company did away with my machine, I would hang at the supervisor's desk until I was told where to go. One day, I'm standing there like I do every morning when an office worker comes up. We'll call her Jane. The supervisor will call Super. This exchange takes place. Jane, we need to find you somewhere else to stand. Me. I stand here so I don't have to look for the supervisor and he doesn't have to look for me. Jane kind of huffs and doesn't say anything else. I thought that was it. Next day. Super. Someone complained that you stand at my desk in the morning? Me. I'm not surprised. Jane said I have to find somewhere else to stand, so it was probably her. Super. I told the office it keeps us from looking for each other. They didn't seem to care. So from now on, when you get here, go stand at your machine and I'll come get you. If I don't come get you, out of sight, out of mind. Understood? Me. Yeah, I got it. So the first week, everything was normal. I got there about 6:30 a.m. and Super would grab me about 7:15 or 7:30. I started work at 7 a.m. The second week, things changed. So apparently Super forgot about me after the first week, so I would just sit at my desk at the back of the plant and take apart and rebuild the same pieces of the machine over and over again. It got so boring sometimes, I would go look for things to do. I know what you're thinking. What's so bad about this? I was, and still am, one of the highest paid machine operators there, so they paid me to rebuild pieces for a machine that was not running. All because someone didn't like the spot I stood in the mornings. Also, to answer the questions, I still work there, I run a different machine, and I still do as little as possible. And our last story. Bother me on my phone? I'll make sure you can't use yours for a day or two. I wake up this morning to a local number calling me. Because of the increase in scam calls from local area codes, I decide to ignore this one. Another call comes in. Ignore. Third call comes in, and I'm thinking that it might actually be someone local and that it must be urgent. I answer and hear, F you, mother effer! Why the F are you calling my phone? I respond with, I don't know who you are. Quit calling my phone, bro. And hang up. I then receive 3 text messages back-to-back stating, quit calling me, B. Lose my effing number, you piece of crap. F you. I'm not in the mood to be called a B and harassed first thing in the morning, so I text him back saying some not-so-nice things, and we have a long crap-talking text conversation back and forth. It escalated with him sending me an address saying to come fight him on the worst street in the worst area of my big city, which I assumed was fake. Instead of physical confrontation, I used the little bit of extra time I had this morning to make sure that the Craigslist world knew that he had a brand new AT&T iPhone 8 64GB for a very reasonable and valuable price, $625. His phone was off within the next 30 minutes of me posting the ad. It's been off ever since, and now it's late here. I decided I'll delete the ad tomorrow. In our back and forth, I told him I'd ruin his day and that he'd know very soon. I just wish I was there to see his face after him figuring out why his phone was ringing off the hook with people wanting to buy his cheap iPhone 8. I'm not going to come fight you, tough guy, but because you caught me on a bad day, I'll gladly ruin yours a little bit. Hey guys, thank you all for watching the video. I'll see you in the next one.